I got one for you. I think Frank Martin's done a terrific job this year. If you look at, he's playing in the SEC. He has been excellent. They're right at 500. They've won some games that they probably shouldn't have. And yet we're still talking about Frank Martin. Is it more so South Carolina kind of being frustrated about their ordeal? They're not even looking at some of this stuff. What? Why is that so persistent?
That's one where if you had asked me 2 weeks ago, I would have said that's for sure opening. And I still would probably lean toward that. But that's one where there's a lot of people in that area saying this job's not opening. He's sticking around. And like, I mean, he's 8-8 in the league. He's 17-11 overall.
Yep.
I mean, they didn't fire him last year after what were they 6-15 last year. And I know there was some state politics involved with all that last spring. But I mean, if they were to keep him, I could certainly see the argument as to why he would stay. I mean, before the Alabama loss over the weekend, they had won 5 in a row. It's very conceivable they finished 9-9 in the SEC. And, you know, if they were to keep him, I don't know how much I would argue it, but, you know, that's been one, you know, outside of Georgia, that's kind of been the one that's been prevalent in hot seat conversations all year.
Yeah. I mean, listen, he went in and I think we all thought he was dead man walking and he probably was. And I'm scared of Frank, so I'm scared of saying anything right now where he might come through the screen and kick my ass. But, you know, I think it's going to be hard. I still think Ray Tanner probably had his mind made up going into the season that this was going to be it for Frank Martin. I think he's going to have to finish strong here and maybe do some work in the SEC tournament to make it difficult for Frank Tanner to maybe give them some momentum, give them a little hope going forward. You know, they got a good recruit coming in. So maybe. Well,
G.G. Jackson is one of the top five kids in the country. If he does commit to South Carolina, that might be the guy that could save Frank Martin's job. Especially, you know, he's been rumored to be exploring a reclassification.
Yeah.
I mean, if you could say, hey, we're going to get a top five kid and we're going to bring him in next fall, it's really hard to fire Frank Martin after going 9-9 in the SEC and signing a top five kid.
And that kid is so good.
Yeah.
All right. So we got 84 likes. Come on, people. Like, we are going to roll here through hot seat. If you guys, I mean, we got to get to at least 100, like, quickly here. Get to 100. Let's see what we can do. Ben Howland, I'm going to say it right now. My sources, Ben Howland, I'd be shocked if he's back. Shocked.
Yeah, I'm in the same boat as you. That's one that I hadn't really, I mean, wasn't really high on my radar like a month ago, and then it started coming in pretty quick. And my sources, I'd be stunned if that one if he was back next year.
What is it, more his decision or is it?
No,
is it
kind of, I think it's the school. It's 7 years now, one tournament appearance, zero tournament wins. I mean, and he's had talent. You know, talent hasn't really been the issue.
They hit it in the portal. We thought they killed it.
They got four really good guys in the portal. And even back, you know, 4 or 5 years ago, they had multiple top 50 kids. And it just hasn't translated on the court. And I think that, and again, Mississippi State's a hard job. Might be the hardest job in the league. But, I mean, you can go to a lot of people and say, hey, we just want one tournament win in 7 years. That's all we need. And I think Mississippi State can find that. And it's, you know, I've never been to Starkville. I've heard it's not all that easy to win it. But one thing I'll say is that Howland got players. Rick Stansbury got players. Rick Ray did not really get players. But you can get.
Do you want me to say why? I mean, do we need to say why?
No, we don't. But okay, I'm saying you can get players to Mississippi State. And I think
Rick Ray was hired to clean up the mess. So you read between the lines.
To essentially not get players. Yes. Yeah.
To not get players. That's right. All right. Here's one. And Greg, you can jump in anytime you want, but I'm going to try to run through a few of these in the SEC. Konzo Martin is a little bit of a difficult one. I mean, listen, this is a guy who's well liked by the administration, by everybody in Columbia as a human being, but they just haven't done enough. I mean, he went to the NCAA tournament, I believe, his first year. Then they've
twice in 4 years.
Yeah, they struggled two, and then last year they went again, but didn't win. Haven't won a game in the NCAA tournament since he's been there. And this year they've been atrocious.
They lost everybody though. They lost literally their top
everyone
eight
loses
players.
Everybody now.
That's the problem, right? It's no longer one underclass.
Yeah, I hear you, but they had one underclassman last year, and then Xavier Pinson decides to leave. Right. So, like, you would talk about a complete, I mean, 10 new players.
Yeah.
It's insane. To go along with what you're saying, everybody does that now.
But hit the portal. Everybody else did. Like, Texas Tech hit the portal, right? And that's how they still had a few dudes. Mm-hmm. But you got to hit the portal, and some guys hit it the right way, and some guys it backfires on, right? It backfired on Ben Howland. Mm-hmm. But I think you have to be assertive unless you're – Jay Wright at Villanova, you got to hit the portal.
Dan Hurley. I think it was UConn, Nova, Purdue, and maybe Northwestern. Maybe, it I don't know. Do Northwestern or Stanford were the only power fives that didn't or high made it. Do you think Missouri opens?
If you had a pick? Yes.
Yeah, I think it's that's one I've changed on. You mentioned my column before. That's one I've changed on since. His buyout's like $6 million, which is
crazy, it's almost, but. Yeah, it's $5+ million.
The thing that's a little Missouri, shocking to me is he's from there. Like,
new AD,
his hometown job.
New AD, right?
Okay. Yeah. That makes sense. New AD. New AD.
She came from UNLV.
Yeah. Desiree.
Reed Francois.
Yep. And she's sharp. She's really sharp. So it'll be interesting. Two more in the SEC before we kind of move forward a little bit. Kermit Davis at Ole Miss. What are you thinking there, Borzella?
That's one I they're not really on my radar. And then a bunch of people mentioned it as something that the school is at least exploring the idea or is considering the idea. And it's only year four. He finished above 500 in the SEC last year, made the tournament his first year. But now I guess the wild card in all this would be Mike White. If he said, hey, I would come back to Ole Miss. And, you know, then maybe Ole Miss can make a move. But if I'm Ole Miss and Mike White is not trying to come, I probably wouldn't make a move. I'd give Kermit another year. I feel it's kind of harsh to get rid of him after 4 years.
I'll go back to it. Years three and four are in a damn pandemic. They've been his, you know, this year was his worst
year. He wasn't
bad
last year. I mean, they were 10-8 in the league.
NIT.
Yeah. Right.
The NIT. Yeah. Mike White is the most interesting one, you know. Florida fans are frustrated with him.
He's made four tournaments, and he's won at least a game in all four tournaments, including an Elite Eight run.
I know. He's not Billy Donovan.
But I think he gets a bad rep just because he's not Billy Donovan. Now, they're probably not going to make the tournament this year, and so that's, throws a wrench in my big passionate defense of Mike White.
Yeah.
But, I mean, I think he's a damn good coach. And I think if he got fired, I think he'd be hired by any number of these jobs that open up.
Well, like you said, Ole Miss would be the easy landing spot if they want, you know, again, if Mike White, maybe he's had it.
It gets out before. Yeah.
You know, and I think the one thing is Mike White's done it differently here last year than this year, right? Last couple of years, he's had a bunch of top 50 players and it didn't really work out great. They were okay. They got the tournament. And like you said, they won a game 2 years ago. And last year
they won a game. Yeah.
Last year. But this year he did it with all transfers.
He has not had great luck with it. I mean, remember Kerry Blackshear committed and everyone kind of made them a Final Four contender. And he didn't really pan out. He has not had great luck going the transfer route.
They've just been okay. Like I looked at it, I did winners and losers. You know, I thought about putting them on the losers. They weren't that bad, their transfers, but they were underwhelming as a group.
Colin Castleton was like the most unheralded transfer he got.
He's been awesome.
And him, Anthony, absolutely. DeRugi, you know, they've been good.